all the examples that we think about when we talk about, you know, machine learning, from like, you know, like hot dog, not hot dog, to like, you know, predicting the stock market, to, you know, like understanding speech, all these things that you really think about classifying things that you've already seen, right? When we look at the MNIST data set, we're talking about labeling numbers 0 through 9, but we're not talking about recognizing other digits that we've maybe never seen before. Right, and in the real world, it's actually common that you want to classify something where you've literally never seen it. And humans can do this really well, right? When I see a spatula for the first time, I recognize it as a new object that maybe I don't know the name for it, but I recognize it, that it's a thing, and I can recognize if I see it again, oh, that's that thing that I saw before. So how do we make computers do this kind of classification? And this is an example that's called sometimes one shot or zero shot or sometimes few shot if you have a couple examples. And it's really been a challenge for machine learning in general to make this work. And one of the approaches that I think is really exciting that I want to talk about today is a kind of reframing of the problem. Right? So instead of looking at one object and saying, what is this object, and training on that, what I want to do is train on pairs of objects where the question is, are these two objects the same? And now what's so cool about that is that if instead of building a classifier of one thing at a time, I build a classifier of pairs of things, I can actually look at something new and look at one example, maybe a canonical example of that thing, and say, is it that thing? Right? So my classifier can potentially generalize not just to classify the things that it's seen in the training data, but maybe to classify anything that it might see out there. And this technique is really generalizable. I'm going to do it on images, but the same approach can be used on video, it can be used on audio, it can be used in tons and tons of different examples. So let's get to it. All right, so let's walk through an example of how we're going to do this. And I'm going to do this on the MNIST dataset at first, just because it's a dataset you're probably familiar with from previous videos, and it's really fast to run experiments on. So first, you know, we have the requisite lots of imports. And then we're going to load the data, and we're going to load it exactly the same as we've done in previous videos, where we load the data into the train. X train is the images, Y train is the labels on the training data, X test is the images on the test data, and then Y train is the labels for the test data. And then we're going to normalize, just like we've done in a lot of other videos, where we just divide the values by 255 so that our pixels are between 0 and 1 instead of being between 0 and 255. But now we're going to do something new. We're going to call this function that I wrote called makePairs. And what makePairs does is it takes in input data and labels, and it makes a new kind of data set where the data set is actually pairs of images. And here the label is actually 1 if the two images correspond to the same category of thing, and 0 if they correspond to different categories of thing. So I just wrote a little bit of code here that actually just randomly walks through digits and then picks other digits that match, and then adds a label of is the same thing, and then it finds two that don't match and adds a label of not the same thing. So what comes out of this is a data set where half the images are same things and half the images are different things. And so this function at the bottom creates a new variable called pairs train, which is going to be the pairs of images, and labels train, which is going to be either 0 for not the same thing or 1 for the same thing. So we can run this here. Oh, we gotta load the data first. Then we can run this guy. And you know, as usual, I always recommend taking a little peek at the data. So why don't we look at pairs train here, 4, 0. And it turns out that is a number 4. That's just an accident. The fourth data set is a 4. And then if we look at pairs train 4, 1, that's actually a different looking 4. So we would expect then labels train 4 to be a 1, meaning that they're the same image. So why don't we just print that out? Labels train 4. And yep. They're the same image. We could look at maybe the 400th example of pairs train. So here that's a 1. And then if we look at the adjacent one, it's another 1. A little bit different writing, but the same thing. So we've transformed our data. And now what are we going to do with it, right? So, you know, naively, one thing we could do is actually just pass in each image into a separate dense network and then concatenate those and have a final dense layer to predict same image or a different image. So that's what we're going to do here. So here our first sequential model is just a flatten and then a dense layer. So this is just the perceptron that you might be used to, but we're going to use a ReLU activation function because it's kind of an intermediate piece. And then we're actually going to have the exact same layer, but a different set of weights. And now here's a new layer you might not have seen before, but it's super useful. It's called concatenate. So what that does is actually just takes two layers, the outputs of two layers, and puts them together into a single set of activations. So no parameters. It just combines the two. And then the final layer, I'm calling dense layer, takes as inputs the things from the merge layer, and then outputs a single number. And hopefully that's going to be a 1. If the images are the same, and a 0 if the images are not the same. So we use a sigmoid activation function because it's kind of a binary classification. And then we use the Keras functional definition to define this because it's actually not a sequential model, right? Because we have two inputs and then we're combining them. It's not just a simple sequential model we might be used to. And so we use a more complicated way of defining it. Then we compile the model. We use binary cross-entropy because we're doing a single binary classification, and we use our standard atom optimizer, and we're going to output the accuracy. So let's take a quick look at what this model looks like before we run it here. And you can see here that we have 100,000 parameters in our dense layer that corresponds to image 1, and 100,000 parameters that corresponds to our image 2, and then each of those fully connected layers, they output 128 numbers. We combine those into 256 numbers, and then we have a single perceptron with 256 inputs and one single output at the bottom of our network. So in total, it's about 200,000 parameters, and we can call fit here. And now again, we'll call fit on actually pairs train 0, right? So that's one of the input images. Pairs train 1, which is the other set of input images, and then labels train, which is again the binary number 0 if the images don't match and 1 if they do match. So let's set that to say 10 epochs and let our model train. So this architecture does work barely. So you know, you can see that at every step it actually is improving the accuracy, but by about like 0.5%, and it's starting at a 50% accuracy. So better than random, which is better than a lot of the networks that I've made in my life, and we're kind of onto something good, but it seems pretty clear that we're gonna need to make this work better. So what we've done so far doesn't work super well. It's unclear actually how well it'll ever work. It does work better than random, but it's not working super well, and it's not typically what people do when they encounter the situation where they wanna do one-shot learning. What they really do is they share weights across the model, right? So sharing weights across layers is actually pretty common in more advanced architectures, but we haven't done it yet. So it's a good thing to know, and it's actually really effective in this case. It's one of the things that we have to do to make this thing really work well. And the intuition is that the model that we're running on the first input image and the model that we're running on the second input image, really it seems like they should be the same model. Right, because the images are drawn from the same set of overall images. And so the transform that we want to do on one image seems like it should really be the transform that we do on the other image. So in order to do this, in order to share weights across the model, we have to actually use more of Keras's functional model definition. And I think this gets a little confusing because when we define a layer in the functional definition, we actually, it sort of just sets up the specification for the layer. And it doesn't actually really attach it to some input until we call a function on that layer once specified. So then we set up a model, right? And so we actually say that the input is going to be this input. And actually what the model does is going to be this flatten step and then this dense step. But now we haven't actually attached this model to any input. So what we're going to do, we're actually going to attach it to two different inputs. We're going to attach it to input 1 and input 2. And so I call the model that's attached to input 1, dense 1, and the model that's attached to input 2, dense 2. So we have two separate models, but they're attached to different inputs. So we can actually take those and we can use that same concatenate layer that we used before to combine them. And then we can add that same dense layer that we had before, and that's going to output a single number. We're going to use a sigmoid activation layer, and that number is obviously going to be 1 if we think that these two images are corresponding to the same number, and zero if they're like two different numbers. So we compile the model in the same way we did before, and then we can take a quick look at it, and we can see that actually this model should have about half the number of parameters of the previous model because we're sharing those parameters, right? So whereas before we had kind of two layers, each with 100,000 parameters, now we only have one set of 100,000 parameters, but it's actually two different layers that are getting called, but each with those shared parameters. So we can run this model too, and spoiler alert, it works a little bit better than the last thing we did, but not a lot better, because there's actually one more fancy optimization that we need to add in. And then we'll have kind of the typical setup of what's called a Siamese network, which is actually an old concept. It was talked about in the 90s, but I feel like it's had renewed interest in various forms as people have gotten more and more excited about deep learning and this kind of one-shot learning problem specifically. So you do from Keras import backend as K, and this kind of harkens back to the time when Keras had typically multiple backends. These days, really, it's almost always TensorFlow. So I just sort of look at any TensorFlow operation as something that I can run here. And now I define a function where it takes in inputs, which are actually going to be TensorFlow tensors, and then I can call K dot and then any TensorFlow operation that I can find. So here I'm using sum and square root and maximum. Really all this is doing is it's basically looking at the sum of the squares of the differences between the two inputs. Right, so it's kind of a simple, they call it Euclidean distance. It's really just how different are the outputs of my two different networks. That's what we're gonna do with it. We're gonna feed in the outputs of each network and then we're gonna compare them using Euclidean distance. So we define this nice little Euclidean distance function, and then we add a new layer. It's called a lambda layer, which implies kind of a lambda function, and we actually pass in our Euclidean distance function. And so now we're actually building our own custom TensorFlow operations as a layer. And what this does is it basically lets the network, instead of trying to figure out what it should do with the outputs of these two networks that we've defined, it just knows that really what I want is the outputs of these two networks to be similar. Right, so the more similar the outputs of my two networks are, the more likely the model thinks that the two inputs are the same, corresponding to the same number. So let's run this network, and we can compile it and look at it just like we did before. And we see that it's very similar to the previous model, but we don't have that last big dense layer to figure things out. And then when we run this network, we actually see a marked improvement, right? In the first epoch, we're already seeing accuracy above 70%. So by taking out some of the complexity and I guess pushing the complexity into the code, we've actually made a much more effective Siamese network. So you know the real reason to do this is not the MNIST data set, right? I mean, it seems unlikely that you'd want to generalize to some other digit that we haven't seen before. But there actually are lots of cases where you'd want to do it. And one case is in handwriting where you might see characters that you haven't seen before. And a super cool data set to do this on that's really fun and a lot like MNIST is the Omniglot data set. So I've actually left in a little bit of code to load in the Omniglot data set, which actually loads in lots and lots of different characters from lots and lots of different languages. And so I think a fun next step to do would be to run this exact same architecture on the Omniglot data set and see if you can recognize characters and actually see if you can build a system that can recognize characters in one alphabet and generalize to other alphabets, because that is really magical and powerful and really shows off why one-shot learning can be really effective and especially why Siamese networks work really well for this application.